So let's go ahead and get started. My name is Meg. Here's my picture here. I'm the support team lead at Pull Everywhere. We have a great support team. We're happy to help you out if you get stuck or just have questions. And there's a bunch of ways you can get in touch with us. The easiest at the bottom right of the page is this question mark box. This is going to send a note directly to our team. It's an email. It'll tell us what page you're looking at. When you send the note, and you can even send a screenshot too. It's pretty helpful. And we try to respond to all emails in under an hour if you email us during business hours, which is 5 a.m. to 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. If you're on a paid plan, you can also call. The number will be at the bottom left of the page. So scroll all the way down. If you see the phone number, you can call us if you're on a paid plan. We also have some help resources up here. If you click help in FAQ, there's a user guide. We've got a special educator guide that goes over all of your specific topics like how to share your account with a TA, gradebook, registration, and even some info for your students if they're having trouble registering for your class or checking their grades, stuff like that. And last, we've got some good videos in here, some tutorials, how to get the polls in PowerPoint on Windows, how to customize your poll chart with visual settings, some stuff that I'm not going to go too detailed in today. So all of those links will be in a helpful email that I'll send you this afternoon, but you can also find them here. So I'm already logged in. Let's go ahead and get started. I'm going to click this My Polls page, link at the top, and this is where all the polls will go. And you can see I have a bunch of stuff in here. When you're getting started, the only thing you'll have is this ungrouped folder. I have some polls that are in groups that I've just collapsed to save space. You don't need to group them, but I'll show you how to do that today too. To get started, we're going to click Create Poll, which is this red button here. And I can type my poll question into this box here. And today we're gonna do one of each type of poll question, just so you can see all the different types we have and how they work. So the first one, I'm gonna do a multiple choice question. And I'm gonna ask you guys kind of how you're planning to use Poll Everywhere. So how often do you plan to use Poll Everywhere? And then the different poll types are listed here on the left, and this one's multiple choice. So it gives me some starter answers of true and false, which is not helpful for this question because it doesn't make sense. So I'm gonna erase them. In these fields, you can put either text or a picture. Keep in mind, if you have a bunch of pictures, they might show up a little small on your chart. We try to fit everything on there. So either text or image will work. And I'm going to say maybe you're planning like one really big event or a conference. You plan to use us once. And I'm going to add another option here for a few times a month. And then I want to add one more field here so I can have another answer. So I'm going to click add an answer. And then I'm going to say monthly. Whoops, this should be a few times a year. Sorry about that. Okay, so that one looks good. I could click create now if I was ready, but I have some more questions I want to ask. Let's do an open-ended question. I am on the East Coast and it's almost dinner time, so my favorite thing to ask is, what is your favorite food? And we'll do open-ended, and we have a bunch of different ways we can display this. So I'll go through all these later. This is not a permanent selection. It's super easy to change it. So I'm going to start with Word Cloud because it's my personal favorite, but we'll go through all four of them and I'll tell you kind of use cases, which one's good for a longer question, which one's good for short, so kind of which to use in which case. Let's do a clickable image poll. So this one is fun. You're gonna supply the image, and your audience is going to click on the image to place their vote. So you could do like a logo contest. You can ask an instructional image, like where on this brain scan is the hypothalamus, or different things like that. You could also do like a Likert scale, or like a this or that type thing where you have two images. So you have the image on your computer and you're going to upload it for this one. So I have a super boring flow chart that we're going to spice up a little. I'll say, where is there most room to improve? And for this one, I'll do clickable image. And click here to upload an image to get started. So I've got one here ready to go. Perfect. So when we get to this one, we're going to physically click on the picture. And the last poll type that I'm going to cover today is the Q&A brainstorm poll. And this is kind of like an extra spin on the open-ended poll. So you're going to ask a question. Your audience is going to respond using free text. So just like, what is your favorite food? They'll be able to type whatever they want. And then this is where it gets really fun. The audience is going to be able to upvote and downvote each other's answer, depending if they agree or they like it. So I'm going to ask, we'll do a fun one. Best vacation spots. And we'll do Q&A brainstorm. So this is good. This one we're doing is a little playful, but we actually use this at Poll Everywhere during our retro meetings where we talk about what happened the week before, what went well, what could we do better. And it's a really great way for us to share feedback anonymously without hurting anybody's feelings. And then everyone can quickly say if they agree or disagree by upvoting or downvoting. So a little less playful than the example we're going to do, but you'll see it's super powerful when we get to this one. So I'm ready. I'm going to click create. So this is going to take me to the first poll in my list. And the poll chart loads on the left, and we have some controls on the right, which I'm going to show you. So I'm just going to activate this poll so that it's open for voting. There's two ways to do it. You can either click the activate button, or you can click this full screen button, and they both do the same thing. But the full screen button will hide all of the controls on the right-hand side of the page. So if you're presenting, you want to click full screen. I actually want to show you those controls, so I'm going to click escape to get out of it, and just activate. So on the right-hand side, we've got some directions here. I can control how people can respond. So if I want it text only, I can uncheck the web option, and that'll immediately update these instructions. If I want it web only, I can do the reverse. And we also have an option for Twitter. Now I want web and text here. And then I also want you guys to be able to respond as many times as you want. So by default, it's limited to one. I'm going to open this up here. If I was a professor or someone who needed to keep track of who said what, I would restrict this poll to registered participants only. This is going to give everyone a message that they need to log in with a special link they can click to quickly log in. Then they'll get credit for their answer. So here's how to do that, so that you don't get anybody who's kind of voting anonymously. You'll be able to see who said what, and if you have grading on, you'll be able, oh, someone's voting. You'll be able to see the grade too. So I guess you guys can go ahead and vote. I'm going to go back into full screen mode now that I showed you those settings, and I'll show you the instructions. So there's two ways to vote. You can send a message to the text message is over here. You can send a message to our phone number, which is 22333. This one works in the US. We do have some international numbers if you need them. But today I'm doing US. So you'll send a text message that says web demo. And that puts you in my session. So you'll be able to vote on all my polls today. And then after you send web demo, you'll be able to send A, B, or C to place a vote. Looks like we got another vote for C. Oh, you guys are clicking C. The other way to respond is at pollev.com/webdemo. So pollev is like an abbreviation for the word everywhere. So you don't have to type the whole thing. So you can go to pollev.com/webdemo. Here we go. It's a little varied now. And just click on the option you want. And I've got this open, so if you guys want to go crazy clicking and watch the chart move, you can. But when you do your polls, the setting is one vote per person unless you change it like I did. Here we go. That looks nice. We've got some display options in here that I'm not going to go into too much detail about because there's an excellent 3-minute video that shows everything. But I can quickly do percentages instead of count if I want. This is good for low participation because nobody knows exactly how low. As long as you've got at least one voter, the bar is moving. But there's a bunch of stuff in here. You could do corporate logo, colors. You could change the layout so it's a column chart. Lots of options in here. So super flexible. You can get it to match your PowerPoint slides if you want. Pick and choose the colors. That's all in visual settings. Looks like there's a question here. Let me see. Max says, why do I not have a 22333 number? So when you're texting on your phone, the two field, like the number you're texting, if you're in the United States, is going to be 22333. If you're in Canada, you can use 37607. If you have an educator's account, you're also going to have 37607, which works in US and Canada. Hopefully that explains that. Okay, so looks like everyone was able to vote on this one. So this is really easy. To get to the next question, I'm going to hit the right arrow key on my keyboard. So this is the what is your favorite food question. This is open-ended, so you guys can respond with whatever you like here, and we'll see it. It'll populate in a word cloud. Seafood. Yum. Larry wants to know if texts are free. So texts are usually free. A standard text message rate could apply. So if a student or an audience member is responding and they don't have a texting plan, their carrier could charge them just the same as if they texted a friend. We don't charge anything, and I think these days most people have a texting plan, but it is possible to go over some of these students. Who knows? So as these different words come in, the word cloud is going to build and move in real time. So the more frequently a word is said, the larger it appears. And I don't know if anybody submitted a two-word response, maybe like chocolate pudding or rice pudding. What it does is it's going to separate all of the words. Word cloud is the only one that kind of messes with the responses. It's going to filter out non-descriptive words, and then it'll separate every word. It's just like Wordle. So you can see ice and cream are separate here. Here's ice. I don't know where cream went. There it is. So it's super fun. This is a great question to ask if you want to say what three words come to mind when you think of our back to school strategy or anything like that. You can limit the number of words, and this can be super powerful. It's also good for one-word responses like these. And let's go into the other display type. So I'm just going to click Visual Settings up here. And Text Wall is the first option. Let's make this a little faster. So this is going to send the responses in two at a time, and they're left aligned. So Chinese and food were submitted before and they were separated. So none of the other display types will separate the words or filter anything out. These are going to be coming in two at a time, predictable and left aligned. It's a massive waste of space for one word answer. See all this white space here? For a short answer, you want to use a different type, which I'll show you in a second. This is really good for long responses. So if you're expecting someone to say a full sentence or explain something, this is good because they'll all be left aligned. So even if it's super long, it's easy to read and it comes in a predictable manner. I'm starting to get hungry. But not good for the short answer. See all this blank space? We can only fit a couple on the screen. Who eats socks? You are fresh. Thankfully, no one's inappropriate. I'll show you what to do if they are. We have some options for that. And don't start with that now, because this is being recorded. So I'm going to click cluster. And cluster fills the screen with little chat bubbles. And the most recent response to come in is the largest. So you can click on one to highlight it, and then it'll stay larger until you guys, until someone writes something else. So there's kind of two ways to manage these responses, and I'm just going to press escape to get out of the presentation mode and show you here. So down here there's a profanity filter, and I'm just going to switch that to block. There's a few options you can do. Disable, which is the default, anything goes. Censor, which is going to add little stars onto the screen. So, depending on your audience, I might not recommend censor. My middle school son would actually like to see the stars on the screen. He'd be proud of that. But you have that option here. And then block is going to block everything with profanity. And it's a pretty encompassing list. It's not perfect, but it gets most of them. You can also tell your audience that if they're responding by text, we can see the last four digits of their phone number, and we'll be able to know who said what. You can even show that on the screen if you need to, so that they're kind of self-policing. But really, the best way to do this is enable moderation. Hopefully it doesn't make it too complicated for you. You can use moderation here, and then you want to moderate from a different device. So not the one you're sharing the screen with. Otherwise, if there was bad words in here, everyone could still see it. Oh, look, no one tried the profanity filter. Thank you. I promise it works. So if we go here, this is really great. You can do moderation from another computer or a phone or a laptop. We have an iPad app. It also works on iPhone, so Apple products. And we have one that works on Android as well, and it's super easy to moderate. That would be probably my suggestion. You could also use a second computer if you have one handy, and we don't care how many times you're logged in. It doesn't matter to us. So you can log in on as many devices as you want and have your colleagues help you moderate however you like. But if I had asked, what questions do you have for the speaker, I could also use moderation to pick and choose what appears on screen. So that's kind of nice. You can hand moderate these so that, some are appearing, or you can, like pick and choose, or do one at a time if you need to. So lots of options with that. I'm just gonna disable this here. Yay, they're all back. And then the last loneliest option here, I'm going to go back in full screen so you have some space. Here we go. The last option that we have is ticker. This is not super frequently used. This is great if you happen to be a wedding DJ or like hosting somebody's bar mitzvah party. otherwise, I'm not sure. I don't know. It's here if you need it. If you're taking song requests or something like that, it's perfect. Messages for the bride and groom. Not super popular in a corporate setting, but you're welcome to use it here if you need it. So, quick recap, WordCloud is going to build in real time. The most popular words will be boldest and largest. Quick way to see audience consensus. Really powerful with a large audience, or if you ask them to use three or five words to describe something, it can be really powerful. TextWall is good for long answers. They're going to come in easy to read in a predictable format. And Cluster fills the screen with little chat bubbles. So this is better for short answers. It's playful. They kind of zip around on screen when a new one comes in. So lots to choose from here. I'm going back to Word Cloud. Okay, I'm ready to go to my next question. I'm going to hit the right arrow key on my keyboard. And this is the clickable image poll. You'll notice there's no texting instructions here. This is web only. This poll and the next poll are web only because they're a little too complex to be handled through one single text message. So you can go to pollev.com/webdemo and click anywhere on this picture to place a vote. Oh, here we go. Somebody clicked adjustments. Bad debts. There, you can get fancy with these clickable images. You can mark an area as correct, like I'll do. Let's make a check. Actually, let's move it over one. And I'm going to say mark clicks in defined regions as correct and save. So if you were to click bank transfer on here, I'll make it so you guys can vote again if you'd like. You should be able to vote again if you already placed. Yay! So bank transfer is right. And I have a little fancy thing. Sometimes these click marks overlap. This is going to count all the clicks for you, so you don't have to be in there. And that looks like three or just a wide two. So it's real interesting. You can use this with the new gradebook report. You can hide the region. So, whoops. Let's see. I want to hide the regions and show the click markers so that people can't see the little box around it. So all of our polls have these options where you can hide and show the results when you're ready. So if you don't want the voters to influence each other, you can hide the results and show them all at once. So pretty fun. Looks like there's a question. This came in earlier, so sorry if I missed it. Janie wants to know about PowerPoint, which I will show after we're done presenting from web. And Janie says, how do you go to the next question? Good questions here. And it looks like Dawn had an error when she was texting. She forgot to text web demo first to join my session. So Dawn, what you want to do is text leave, then text web demo. Doesn't matter right now because the next two polls are not they're not text enabled. Larry wants to know if this works on iPhone. It should, so give it a try. You don't need the app; it should just work in your Safari browser. Well, you guys have good questions today. Will wants to know, are all responses on here anonymous? So you can make a poll specifically anonymous so that we're not tracking any information. If you're on a free account or have not set up paid participation, you won't be able to see who said what, but you'll be able to correlate all the responses that came from the same person. There are a few different options. When I run the report on these, you can see the majority of these will come in as unregistered since I didn't ask you guys to sign in or sign up. Oh, you guys are fast. So I'm on this best vacation spots, and not a ton is going to happen on this chart right away. Let me show you how it looks to vote. I'm just going to click this link here. So this will work on your phone or anywhere. So if I want to say any beach, well, not breach, beach, submit. And then you guys have the option to upvote and downvote each other's responses. Oh, somebody doesn't like Western Australia. Well, I do. I'll upvote you. So you can upvote and downvote the responses here. I love New Orleans. I do agree. Any vacation spot is a good one. So you guys can go in here and if you like it, upvote it. If you don't like it, downvote it. I'll try to balance out some of these negative ones. So this is really fun. And then as you guys are voting, you can see stuff gets categorized on the chart by frequency of, or I guess highest number of upvotes. And you can see the controversial ones here that have one upvote and one downvote, you can see. So this is really fun. And how we use this in our meetings, I'm going to leave a bad one so we can all practice downvoting. Let's do that. This presentation is the worst. Meg is so boring. ZZZ. So feel free to upvote that one if you want to. But it's a good one so we can all practice downvoting. So when somebody says something super off topic in our meeting or something inappropriate or just not really agree with, everyone loves, oh, you guys are so cute. Thank you for massively downvoting that. Everybody loves to downvote. So people will say, great job on the new gradebook report. It looks awesome. I can't wait to show our educators. And everyone will upvote it. And somebody will say, we should ship new stuff every day. And like half of the team upvotes it. And then somebody will say something totally off topic, like we ran out of fruit snacks at the office or something like that. And we just love to downvote it. Or somebody's making fun of someone's haircut or something terrible. We just, you know, to the bottom of the list with you. So this is super fun. You can use it for like a discourse type discussion. And it's a quick way to get an audience consensus without hurting anyone's feelings. And it's super fun. So there are a few options that you have as the presenter to go through these responses that have been upvoted and downvoted. So if I want to pin one and talk about it, I can click this little pin icon and it moves it to the top of the list, even though it's not number one. So you can either come back to it or just save it for later. You can unpin it too, and it'll go back to its little spot. I also have the option to feature one, which is really great if you have like a focus issue with your group. I know attention is hard sometimes, especially if they have out a device for their voting. So we do this in our meetings. We feature it. So it kind of blurs out everything in the background and everyone knows exactly which one we're talking about and the focus is here. So I can talk about, oh, my sister graduated from Tulane University. I loved visiting her there. New Orleans is a top pick. Then when I'm done, I can click it and it goes back to the list. If you don't want to feature them or you did feature them and you're now done talking about it, you have this dismiss option on the left. So I can say, Hawaii's fabulous. Dismiss. I really agree. I'd love to go to any beach. I love the sun. You know, go through these one at a time. So super easy and powerful for the audience to feel like they are contributing, as well as it gives people a chance to say if they agree or disagree. And even your shy members of the audience are not too shy to click a plus or a minus or, you know, like an upvote or a downvote arrow. And it's similar to the website Reddit. So a lot of the younger audience is used to the concept of upvoting or downvoting. So super fun. You guys have some great vacation spots. I wish I was on vacation right now. And that's it. So we did all four polls. And super easy. So let's run a quick report on these. On the My Polls page, I can see here are my four polls. You can see which one is active because it's green. And if I wanted to take it offline, I could click it again. And now there are no polls at pollev.com/webdemo. So you have this blank page. And the audience won't see this. This is because I'm logged in and looking at my own voting page. So they'll just see this blue, dark blue part of the page. So you can quickly see which poll is active. You can see how many responses they are. If you're close to your limit, If your plan comes with 50 responses per question, and this was at 44, this would start to turn red. So I can see from that to run out as well. So let's run a quick report on these. I'm going to check all four boxes and click report. Here it is. And have a couple of report types. I'm going to show you more than one. Let's see. Let's start with executive summary. This is going to show you kind of just the big overview. So you'll get a screenshot of all of your polls on the left, and a breakdown in responses. So let's see how many people are actually on this webinar. I see I have 27 people attending, and oh, you guys are close. The system thought there were 26 people. So somebody is silently sitting there, whoever you are. So I'm going to update this so my percentages will be correct. If you know there's 50 people in the room, and this will update all of the engagement stats. So you get engagement stats for each of the polls. And you'll notice not all of the polls have all of the information in here. So this is like a limited screenshot. So this is just a brief overview. All of the reports you can download to CSV. And if you need the full picture, if you need to know what people are saying on the open-ended questions, you'll want a more detailed report. So we've got all of these fancy ones. I'm going to do participant response history. And this is going to group it by person. So I think I should be the only person who logged in because it didn't require it. So you guys are going to show up as unregistered. So here's me. I responded to only two of the polls. You can see basically who said what this way. This person did a lot of clicking. They said a few times a year. They love chocolate and pineapple. This is all from the same person. So it kind of correlates who said what, some additional information. So it's not totally anonymous. You could ask an open-ended question asking for their name. And that way, if you're on the free plan, you can still see who said what. Don't tell sales I'm giving all these little secrets away. The registration comes with all of the paid plans, even the $19 plan. So it's really not that tricky to set up. But we're going to correlate all the responses from the same device. And if I had asked you guys to register, your name would show up here as well. The gradebook is really beautiful. We only had one graded poll, so it's probably not that powerful. Let's actually see what that's going to look like on here. I'm going to remove the non-graded polls. So let's take out these. And I could turn grading on for the multiple choice poll if I want. There's a couple other tricks I can do with it that I didn't show you. That's in the edit menu of the poll to pick which answer is right. So, if you had logged in, your names would be here, and I can see who got it right, who got it wrong. And then if I am using participant groups, I could select my class here, and I can also see who in the class did not respond. So, really powerful report. We've got some more info. We have a blog about it, and there's some info in the guide. So, this we just updated for you guys for back to school. So that's reports in a nutshell. There's a bunch of different reports you can run. Let's group these guys. I like to stay organized. So I'm going to check four boxes here and click the button that says group. And now I have a new group down at the bottom, and I have a naming scheme going on here. So let's call this August 20th webinar. Ta-da! Okay, so now I'm organized. I feel better now. Can relax. You don't have to group them. They worked perfectly when they are in ungrouped. So grouping gets you two things. You can get a survey view. So this only works for multiple choice questions and open-ended questions. See, the others are grayed out. So if you want to ask a multiple choice question or an open-ended question and have a whole bunch, you can send it out as a one-page survey that they can fill out so they're not voting on them one at a time. That's a benefit of putting it in a group. And you can also just keep organized. So not mandatory, but kind of nice. A couple other things I want to show you. Let's do PowerPoint. So I'm on Mac. Mac PowerPoint looks a little funny if you're used to Windows. Before you do any polling in PowerPoint, you're going to need the app. You need it for Mac and Windows. It's free, works on all of the plans, even the free plan. You get it at polleverywhere.com/app, like application. And you just click here, you'll download it. It looks different on a Windows machine. So if I was on Windows, I have this ribbon across the top, which looks totally different on Windows. And you'll get one of these tabs in here will say Poll Everywhere. That's what you installed, a tab in the ribbon. And you'll use that tab. It'll give you some really easy, it's like two buttons. So pretend this one says Insert Poll Slide. You'll click that and you'll pick the polls. So I'm on Mac, so I get this fancy guy here. I want today and insert polls. Okay, so now I can play the slideshow. This should be blue and white, fingers crossed. Hooray! Okay, so as you progress, whichever, it's the same as when I present on web. So whichever poll I have open in PowerPoint is the only one people can vote on. So if you look now at pollev.com/webdemo, you'll see this poll is live and you guys could vote on it if you wanted to and the chart would move. Yay. Okay, thanks guys. Good demonstration. So I can progress my slides. You notice as I move through these, it updates the website for you if you're trying to vote. And I move through this, it just refreshes the page for you when I get to a new poll. So the audience always keeps up with you. And then the controls, if you need them, are still here to the right, just like on the website. They'll appear anytime you hover your mouse there. They disappear if you don't. So yeah, those are the same polls in PowerPoint with your regular presentation slides. So present from web, works on any recent browser, Chrome, Firefox, Safari, Internet Explorer, even Internet Explorer. So IE9 or newer, please, but it'll work perfectly and you don't have to worry about installing anything. If you would like the polls to be in with your slideshow, you can install the optional PowerPoint add-in for Windows or Mac, and then the polls will be part of your slideshow. The software does need to be installed on the computer you're using to present. So if you're going to a conference room to present, you will want to install PowerPoint add-in, polleverywhere.com/app on that computer as well. And if you, for some reason, panic at the last minute, you don't have access to that computer, just present from web. It's all there and it'll work. Perfect. So that's PowerPoint, super easy. And it's nice if you have other polls to keep everything kind of in the same place. So Will wants to know if I use LaTeX to create my PowerPoints, what would you suggest? How one to use to display the poll. So you can use LaTeX is the math language. You can actually use that in your multiple choice options. We totally support that in your polls if you want to. You'll need PowerPoint or a Keynote to do the embedded PowerPoint polls. So it works on PowerPoint or Keynote. Great questions, guys. Let's go over some account settings that you need to change before your event. This is important. So if you click settings at the top, the first field on the settings page is where you can set your username. So web demo was the word you texted to join my polls, And it's also this address you go to place a vote. So I think all of the paid plans, except for the $19 plan, come with this option. So you'll need to be on a paid plan to change this. You can pick any word that's not in use by another customer. Otherwise, we're going to give you a combo of your first and last name. So I know some teachers don't like the first name showing up, so be careful. Then on this first and last name field, you can put anything you want here. It doesn't have to be your real first and last name. We don't use it for billing, so you can update this. Mine says Poll Everywhere Webinar. And if I didn't update it, it would say Meg Boyle. And when you send a text to join my session, we send a reply that says you have joined first name, last name, apostrophe S session. So we're getting it from right here. So if you're working on something for a corporate event or something where you don't want your name, feel free to change it here. If I didn't change it, if anyone voted via text, you would have got a text that said, you've joined Meg Boyle's session. it doesn't bother me, but I like to just show you how you can customize that. If you get a look and feel of a poll, so say you tweak the colors and it's looking gorgeous and you have a logo or a background or some kind of style that you like, you can set it for a template for all your other polls so you don't have to try to recreate that. That's here on the profile page. And the last thing you want to do is how long do you want your polls to stick around for after you activate them? Your default is 3 hours. So let's say you are presenting, you're on stage, you present your last poll, and then you walk off stage. That poll is going to stay live for 3 hours unless you click deactivate. If you're on stage for longer than 3 hours, I am so sorry. That sounds like a very long day. You have a couple options to stop the poll immediately. You could lock it or you could click deactivate. But sometimes you want to actually have these polls around for longer. So maybe you're not doing a live event or you want it to be open all day to gather feedback, or you're doing a pre-event survey, or even like a you're sending out an email with a link and you want it to be open. And we have lots of options for you. 3 hours, 1 day, 1 week, or 30 days. So if you need longer than 3 hours, please change this setting here. We also have some international text messaging numbers. This is what I was talking about earlier. If you're in the US and you're an educator, you'll have 37607. If you want to change it to 22333, you can. It'll charge us more, but it's fine. You can pick any of these numbers here that you like. 37607 works in the US and Canada, and a bunch of these are combo numbers. So if you have a mixed audience, it makes it easy. The default for the business plans is 22333. Some people like to have a 10-digit number. You can choose that if you prefer here. So lots to choose from. Should work as is, but if you find out you want to change it, you can do that here on the settings page and then click international text messaging. And that's really everything I wanted to show you guys. If you have any questions, now's the time to ask them. I will send out this super helpful email with some of the links I talked about earlier, and you're welcome to reply to that email with any questions that you have. My team and I are happy to help you in the classroom or at your event. Just have polling success. So we're here to help. Oh, here we go. I was going to say no questions have come in. Jamie said, thanks. This was very helpful. Yeah, my pleasure. I love to do this webinar and teach everybody how to be a polling pro. Here we go. Thank you, Henry. That's very sweet. So I guess I'm going to wrap up today. I'll send you guys this superb email here shortly in a few minutes, and feel free to reply if you think of anything last minute. Thanks so much, guys.